was just asking.
Good morning, and welcome to worship at Vinewood. We're so glad that you could join us. The call to worship today reads from Psalm 29, 1 to 2. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. So I invite you to stand as we worship our God who is worthy of all praise.
Who else commands all the hosts of heaven? Who else could make every king bow down? Who else can whisper in darkness tremble? Only a holy God. What are the beauty demands? Such praises. What of the splendor outshines the sun? What of the majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God.
Come in. Come in.
Come and behold him, the one and the only, crying. was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed.
He was pierced.
He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice. And the life that you gave, we are healed for you paid the price. By your grace we are saved, we are saved. He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds, by his wounds. We are healed by your sacrifice. In the life that you gave, we are healed, for you paid the price. By your grace we are saved, we are saved. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Sin. my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is
If you can bow your head and pray with me. Father God, I thank you for this morning that we're able to gather here together as a body to worship you, to glorify you, to sing songs of praise to you. God, I pray for our congregation today as we come in heavy burdened, perhaps weighted with sorrow or stress, with maybe just the daily monotony of work and study. Some of us are grieving, I know, God. Some of us are anxious. Some of us are angry. Some of us are frustrated. I pray, God, that we would come to you today earnestly desiring to bring our entire heart to you, God. I pray that you would, through your Holy Spirit, visit our congregation and encourage us, God, not to take away the burdens that are in our life, God, not to lift them from us, but God, I pray that through you, we would be able to overcome them, that we would be able to persevere through them, always rejoicing in you in gladness, God. Father, we want to pray for our wider community, for our world, God, as well. We know that there is such suffering and hardship, especially in our local neighborhood and in our state, with such severe weather and coldness. God, we pray that you would bring comfort to families who are afflicted by this weather, that you would bring swift healing and comfort and shelter. God, we pray for, of course, the ongoing conflict in Ukraine. We know that there is great suffering and violence, God, that every day people wake up with the terrible truth that they are under assault, that their loved ones are in danger, God. I pray that you would bring wisdom and a peace to that land, that you would unite world leaders, that you would help people to put politics aside in striving for peace in that region, God. I pray for our sermon today here, that we would come to with humble hearts, with open ears, ready and willing to receive your word as it is preached to us. In your name we pray these things. Amen. You can have a seat. Oh, actually, sorry, before you have a seat, if you could turn to one another, greet one another, and if you notice someone that's new here today, maybe you've not met them before, give them a good morning and welcome. All right, everyone, if you could have a seat, we'll go ahead and get started. Well, good morning. It's really, really good to see you all here today. I'm going to go ahead and start off with some announcements before we go ahead and pick up with our sermon for today. Our first announcement is that we have started releasing, again, our Sunday bulletins online every week, each Wednesday before service. So if you want to, let's say, take a look and preview the passage that's going to be preached that coming Sunday. If you want to just check up on our announcements, what's coming up next, you're always free and welcome to take a look through vinewoodcfc.com, where we post, again, all of our stuff, all of our announcements. The next announcement is, of course, if you're a newcomer, if it's your first, your second, your third, even your fourth time here, if you're a newcomer, you feel like you're new, you're probably new. We'd like to welcome you. We'd like to get you connected with one of our small groups, one of our fellowships, too. So if you came through the door, you should have gotten a little Get Connected card. If you can fill that out, or if you didn't get one, you could fill out our digital card on our website, vinewoodcfc.com, under the Get Connected tab. The next announcement is that Vinewood membership classes are opening back up again, and it's open to anyone that's interested in becoming a member here of our church. This is going to take place in room 201 on March 12th at 11:15 a.m. 201, by the way, upstairs classroom right over here. If you've only attended CFC for a few weeks, even if you would, you know, consider yourself maybe even a newcomer, or if you're interested in finding out what membership is like here at Vinewood, we'd highly encourage you to check out that class. Just coming to the class doesn't commit you to becoming a member, but it does start you on that path, and it is a great way to find out what we're all about here. Our next announcement is we are very, very excited to announce that we have two short-term mission trips that are coming up quite soon. The first is July 15th through the 22nd. That is a trip to the Duckwater Reservation in eastern Nevada, working with the Shoshone tribe there. This is a Vinewood-only missions trip, and actually, we have some members here that have attended this missions trip before. So if you want some more specific information about that, I encourage you to perhaps reach out to Esther, our admin, who, if you can raise your hand, Esther, she's right there. She's attended that trip before. It's a great opportunity to serve the local community there. Highly encourage you to chat with her if you have more questions about that. The second opportunity is July 11th through the 22nd. It's a trip to Taiwan, where we're serving a summer camp there for students up to the middle school age, helping to run a VBS and a summer camp there. We'll also be, very, very helpfully, teaching some English to those kids. So if you feel the call and desire to serve some of those children there and you got some English skills, highly, highly encourage you to consider that opportunity. And if you're interested, you can contact, again, our admin Esther or Richard Ho, who is actually overseeing many of our short-term missions opportunities. Richard, where are you? He's right there. So if you have any questions, find them after service. And we'd like to remind everybody as well to save the date on our next announcement. Save the date for our summer retreat coming up on July 7th through the 9th at Sonoma State University, the beautiful campus we were at last year. There will be more details, sent out in the coming weeks, but just make sure you put that on your calendar. And we also want to go ahead and remind everybody that our post-sermon implementation ministry is continuing. I'm personally really, really heartened to see a lot of the great conversation and activities that we have after service. And so we'd just like to remind you that you're going to continue setting up tables outside after service today for a discussion about the sermon. You can sign up, by the way, to be a lunch buddy for a chance to meet people from other fellowships at Vinewood. So let's say if you are in Crossroads and you'd like to get to know some of us young adults, or if you'd like to get to know some of the Agape students here, it's a great way to kind of get paired up, have lunch together, get to know one another, and serve one another outside of our general fellowships. And it's Buddy Lunch is going to be happening after service next week on the 12th, so please talk to those on the post-sermon implementation team if you have more questions. The one contact person I know right off the bat is Monica. Monica, where are you at? Yeah, she's right there. Go ahead and talk to her if you want to find out a little bit more about that. And Finally, we do hold regular prayer meetings every morning at 8 a.m. before Sunday service. So if you'd like to join us, we'd love to have you come with us and pray for our community here, our church, and the wider world. If you missed out, it's okay. We'll be here at 8 a.m. next week. We also have a Zoom link available, but we highly encourage you to come in person with us, room 202, 8 a.m. every Sunday. And if you have offering this morning, we would encourage you to give online via Zelle Pay or PayPal. Information for that can be found on our website at vinewoodcfc.com. And I'm going to go ahead now and welcome up Pastor Dennis, who's going to continue our sermon series for today.
Good morning, everyone. If you have your Bible, please turn to Matthew chapter 26. We are in Matthew chapter 26 this morning, from verses 57 through 68. Matthew 26, verses 57 through 68. There seems to be this pattern that maybe you'll see or maybe you've recognized from time to time that the pattern happens like this. Some video goes viral and some person's just being like nasty, right? They're doing something racist or rude or unkind or whatever it is, and it gets released and then people will kind of comment and just like, you know, rake them through. And then there's always like a statement that gets released, especially if it's like a celebrity of some sort, right? And the statement usually kind of goes along the lines of this. This is not who I really am, right? My friends and family, you can ask them. I am not typically a fill in the blank, whatever it is, right? And goes, I'm not normally a racist. I don't normally yell at strangers. I don't typically push little children to the ground, right? And then they'll like say those things like, that's not really who I am. Like that video actually doesn't describe who I am. I'm actually this really nice, kind person. Just so happened that this video portrays something different. And every time when I watch this, I wonder to myself, I'm like, then who's the person in the video? I always thought about it to myself. I'm like, that's really odd that, you know, they'll maybe like dig something up and then I wonder, like, then who are you, really, if this video doesn't portray the real you, so to speak? And I think oftentimes we all like to think for ourselves, we have like this baseline goodness that we believe that we are. And we want to believe for ourselves that we're genuinely like really good people that sometimes do bad things. And that's kind of like the main thread of it all. No matter how whatever video that comes out, or no matter what is being accused of, we all, even for ourselves, we like to think that I'm a genuinely good person. I sometimes might slip into something really bad, but that's not who I really am. I'm actually someone much better. Now, if we are really that, then in that case, it's going to be really easy for us to approach this morning's passage with actually some sort of a condescending attitude. We can think to ourselves, I will never be like these type of people in the narrative we're about to read. We might think to ourselves, which is probably very true, we'll never be wrong, so wrong or so evil in that way. In terms of, if I were to venture a guess this morning, I would guess a high majority of you will never murder an innocent man. I don't think you would ever be in a position to murder the Son of God himself. Yet we must be careful this morning not to forget that sin leaves no part of our lives untouched or uncorrupted. And so while it may be true that none of us may ever venture down this dark road of depravity, like these leaders that we're about to read in the dead of night, that they're going to go and try to unjustly condemn Jesus, while we might not do that, our depravity still puts us down roads they've traveled before. We might not repeat all their actions, but we certainly can relate to the same corruption of heart and the same impulse that wants to protect our own kingdom and our own idols. When confronted with the truth in the Gospel of Matthew that Jesus is the one true king, we find ourselves either yielding or rejecting. So we're going to pick up where we left off last week, where Jesus was betrayed by one of his own, arrested, and now marched into this kangaroo court where they're looking for any sort of testimony that will allow them to render a guilty verdict, punished by death. So we see this first trial by the Sanhedrin, and what we want to get away from this morning, this passage that we want you to, what I want you to walk away with is this. Christ's trials reveals the depravity of our hearts and the humility of his. Christ's trials reveals the depravity of our hearts and the humility of his heart. Would you please follow along as I read from verse 57, chapter 26, from verse 57 all the way to verse 68. Verse 57. Then those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered. And Peter was following him at a distance as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus that they might put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, "This man said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days." And the high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?" But Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, "I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." And Jesus said to him, "You have said so, but I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his robes and said, "He has uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment?" They answered, "He deserves death." Then they spit in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is it that struck you?" This is the word of the Lord. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, this morning we come before you, reminded of the great travesty and injustice that your son faced, the cruelty, the pain, the suffering, the disrespect, the dishonor, the shame that he bore. I pray, Lord, that we will be able to see how it was truly our sins that caused this grave and terrible thing to happen. But we are also thankful, Lord, that as we sung this morning, through the blood of your son, we are now forgiven and saved. So I pray for eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to receive your word this morning. For all this in your son's name, amen. So in our very first point in verse 57 through 61, what I want us to see and understand is actually our depraved hearts tries to discredit Christ. Our depraved hearts try to discredit Christ. So after Jesus was arrested, we're told in verse 57, they led him to the high priest, Caiaphas, where the scribes and elders, they've all gathered. They were waiting for Jesus to come, and they're ready to kind of start this informal trial. And if you recall in Matthew chapter 26, verses 3 and 4, we're told that the chief priests and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, the same man, and they plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. While this did not go completely to plan, they didn't want to do this during the feast, but they couldn't pass up on Judas selling out his master. So this was going as well as they had hoped for. So we are now seeing that their plans are being set in motion. They set up this kangaroo court in the house of Caiaphas, the high priest, and Peter, the lone disciple, who seemingly didn't abandon Jesus, followed him and hung out in the courtyard of the area of the house, hoping to get a glimpse of Jesus. We'll see what happens with him next week. But at this present moment, he's lingering in between courage and cowardliness. So he, unlike the rest of the disciples, I guess haven't fully abandoned Jesus just yet. Now, we know the intentions of this gathering, of these elders, scribes, and chief priests. And if you recall and remember that this is probably the Sanhedrin, like the council that rules over, the religious council that will rule over and make all these civic, religious rulings. Now, this may be the whole council, all 70 plus of them, but most likely this is a quorum, so maybe 20-something of them. And here they are, looking for any sort of testimony to accuse Jesus of something, of anything, whatever they can get their hands on to put him to death. But the reality is they couldn't find anything and took him a long time. The court scene actually seems to be quite ridiculous. If you ever watched the movie Monty Python and the Holy Grail, this is also before my time, so you're looking at me as if like, well, you're old, Dennis, of course you like this movie. This is even before my time. I would highly suggest, it is comedy, okay? But in this movie, there is this scene where the crowd is accusing this woman of being a witch. And they were looking for any sort of evidence. They just tried to accuse her of being a witch. They would do whatever they can. They dressed her up as a witch. They put a fake nose on her. And they've even made these boisterous claims that this man, in their midst, she turned him into a newt, but he got better. So that's why he's a man. But they were making these claims of the things she was doing. And kind of the conclusion of all of this is what they've come to was this. This is their logical conclusion. Wood burns, wood floats, duck floats. So if this woman weighed the same as a duck, that means she's made out of wood, which burns. And what do witches do? Witches burn. So therefore, she's a witch. And you're watching this whole thing. It's like, this is the most ridiculous thing you've ever seen. But then you see the crowd. They're like, yes, burn the witch. Burn the witch. Burn her. And here, this is kind of like what's going on. They're like trying to find what anything. This is like grasping for air. And they're just grasping for anything to be able to accuse Jesus so they can kill him, like whatever it takes. But the thing is, they still kind of have to act like they're a court in some form or fashion. They can't go completely off the rails. So they have to have corroborating evidence. And so scripture tells us that you need to have at least two witnesses for you to be able to make a claim. So we see here, there's a whole bunch of people here that make all these crazy claims about Jesus, but there's not a second person to corroborate it. So we see it here that they're saying they call them false witnesses. And all of these are essentially false witnesses. They're just making stuff up. But they found something finally where they got two people to come forward to make this claim that this man said, or this fellow, Jesus, they're talking about, said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days. That was the best they got. If you can think about it, like, that doesn't seem like a lot. And the reality is, it's not really that much. In the minds of the court, the verdict is already decided. He's guilty. Whatever you want to put up in front, he's going to be guilty of it. They just need you to give him something, give the court something so he can be guilty. So they figured, well, we got two people that say the same thing. Let's run with this one. And so they're trying to figure this out. And so first, well, they incorrectly quoted Jesus. John chapter 2:19, Jesus actually says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Now, you might think that doesn't seem to warrant a death penalty. And you're right. In the eyes of the Jews, for you to make this sort of claim would not result in some sort of death penalty. But it may be for the Romans. And you see, as powerful as this group think they, as they want to be, they actually do not have the ability to execute Jesus. They don't have that authority. They need the Romans to actually give them that authority and to actually do it on their behalf. So what they really care about is trying to kill Jesus. And here, the Romans, as we'll see later on, that Jesus is going to be accused of blasphemy. The Romans don't care about that. They're not going to execute somebody for blasphemy. But destroying religious buildings and causing a potential insurrection. Now, that is something that they're willing to execute you for. So this is why this is kind of important, because they finally found something that they can at least bring to the Romans and say, see, look, he is trying to start an insurrection. He's going to try to destroy our temple and try to do all these things. And that is going to get the Romans' attention. But for them, for the Jewish people and their court and what they're trying to do, doesn't really get anywhere. But they figured they'll hone in on this because they need some sort of ammo to kill Jesus. So they want to distort his character, they want to twist his words, and they're kind of construing something that seems logical for them to reject and discount Jesus. And so they're like, let's just run with this. And here's the thing, when our hearts are so depraved, and our depraved hearts, when it's confronted with Jesus, when our hearts are sin, cursed, and corrupt, and it's confronted with Jesus, the only way that we try to wriggle out of it is that we try to discredit Jesus so we don't have to follow Jesus. The high priest and all these elders and chiefs, they don't want to listen to Jesus. They're looking for anything and anything to discount Jesus, discredit Jesus, so they can just have it their way. They have no plans in their minds to ever listen to what he really has to say, his claims, or any of that sort. And apart from the Holy Spirit bringing about faith, our own sin-corrupt hearts seek for ways to discredit Jesus as well, no matter how false those claims may be. See, the reality here is that there is not enough evidence to present this group to ever accept Christ. You can't present enough evidence to this group for them to actually be like, oh, we changed our mind, you're right. Christ maybe is the Messiah. We probably should listen to him. Even if the voice of God came down and proclaimed Christ as his son, which happened in Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, it wouldn't matter. And the way maybe we go about kind of echoing this type of sentiment, it might not be as obvious as this trial. We might not be thinking that, well, I'm not putting Jesus on trial, I'm not doing these things, but the temptation is actually still there. See, we discredit Jesus in different ways. We do it when we choose to not trust Christ, or when we deem him to be untrustworthy or unwise. Maybe we find his ways unconvincing or overly demanding, or maybe we're just trying to find ways to attack his character. Actually, this happens in the midst of great suffering or tragedy for us. Maybe we believe things like he's not good, or he's not powerful, or maybe he's just simply non-existent. We discredit Christ when we minimize our own sins. When we say that it's not a big deal, it's like, whatever, it's no big deal. We rationalize it. We think we deserve it. We're finding ways to find Christ guilty in that way so we don't have to follow him. Like, oh, you don't understand. It's easy for us to try to rationalize why we do what we do. And the only way we can actually rationalize it when confronted with Christ is either to discredit him or just flat out reject him. And we might just want to put Christ's influence over our lives to death so we can be the ones in charge. And our depraved hearts, when it gets too deep, it starts to grasp for any reason to hold on to what we want. And the irony of it all, and what we're going to see actually in this passage, is like a whole bunch of irony. It's just super ironic of how everything goes about. Because what the Sanhedrin proclaims to be truth is actually false, and what they proclaim Jesus to be false is actually true. So there's like a lot of irony here. And the irony here is that when Christ is talking about the temple being destroyed and raised up in 3 days, in John chapter 2, verses 21 and 22, it says this, but he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus has spoken. Jesus wasn't even talking about the temple right there. though in 70 AD, that temple will ultimately fall, but not specifically by Jesus. He was talking about his own death and resurrection. Jesus was proclaiming why he came, and he was actually prophesying his death, the one that he's actually marching to through the hands of these people. The death that he died for rebellious and depraved hearts so we can be made clean, right, forgiven, and reconciled to God. Unknowingly, they were trying to discredit Jesus with the gospel. And the gospel tells us that Jesus is the Son of God, the truly divine, that came down as truly man, who lived a perfect life, so he can be that perfect sacrifice, this sacrifice that's actually being executed by this very group of people. He will eventually die on a cross to pay for the penalty of sins, the sins that infects our rebellious heart. He rose 3 days later, conquering sin and death through his life, his death, and his resurrection. We have a way to be made right with God. And his righteousness is now credited to all those who confess and repent of their sins. For those who place their faith in Jesus and what he'd done on the cross, his resurrection becomes our resurrection. The hope he offered is realized with the empty tomb. The only perfect, holy, righteous person to walk the earth was condemned because his presence, his authority, his power threatened the status quo of those in charge. But isn't that all of us? Doesn't the gospel threaten our very way of living? Don't we find ourselves sometimes scrambling, wanting to find ways to downplay or discredit Jesus so we don't have to fully follow him? Jesus challenges all of us this morning. Either surrender to his will or surrender our will to him, or fight a losing battle till the bitter end. And while we might not take it as far as these scribes and elders that we might think to ourselves, but they're actually merely acting out what happens internally when we choose to reject Christ. See, they're just taking it to the logical conclusion, but we're still traveling down those same roads. But not only are depraved hearts trying to just discredit Christ, like, oh, he doesn't know what he's talking about, or he's not really God, or oh, we don't have to listen to him, or like, oh, my sin's not that bad, I'm actually a good person. We do more than that. Actually, the ultimate reason is our depraved hearts actually reject Christ's authority. Like, we don't want to listen to him. Look at me, verse 62 through 65. And it says this, and the high priest stood up and said, have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you? But Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, you have said so, but I tell you from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest tore his robes and said, he has uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. We're told Jesus remained silent during these ridiculous accusations because we already know that he has wrestled with his heavenly Father in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's left with this resolute desire and to live out the will of God. He left knowing that he will obey God and his will. He trusts in his ways. So he's not there to prove himself, but actually he is there to be obedient to the Heavenly Father. So he doesn't even bother trying to stand up for himself. if you think about it, these are really, really ridiculous accusations. Like I mentioned before, right, this claim is weak at best, at least for this court. So while it's proof, while this will prove to be useful later on to the Romans to maybe try to convince the Romans to execute Jesus, it's not really enough for the Sanhedrin. And they know it. And so that's why we see Caiaphas, the high priest, he stands up, perhaps sensing that maybe he can get Jesus to incriminate himself. That would be the nail of the coffin, right? Try to get Jesus to speak. Try to get Jesus to say something about this. And so he stands up, and actually, for us, we don't quite realize this because obviously this is not our culture. But this is a really odd thing, an unusual thing to do for the high priest to stand. And so the fact that he stands up would really punctuate his words, because everyone would be like, whoa, why is he standing? And so he's actually, now I am going to address Jesus personally by his kind of authority. He stands up and goes, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. He's demanding for an answer from Jesus. And as one commentator puts it, Caiaphas is not searching for understanding, but for ammunition. He is trying to find a reason to kill Jesus. So he puts Jesus under oath by saying this. Jesus is now, he has to respond. He is now under oath. And Jesus responds by saying, you have said so. Another way of maybe interpreting exactly what Jesus is saying is, that is your word, not mine. Or maybe I would have not put it that way, but since you said it and you put it that way, I'm not going to deny what you said. You might wonder, why would Jesus respond in that way? See, what Jesus meant by saying that is he understands that people at that time had a very different understanding of what the Messiah is. What is he supposed to look like? What is he to accomplish? And many of them saw this position and person as a political figure, not necessarily a spiritual one. Time and time again, we know that the people had very different expectations of this so-called Messiah. We even saw that in a couple weeks ago, kind of exploring, why would Judas betray his master Jesus? And one of the reasons is most likely he had a very different expectation and understanding of Jesus as Messiah, and when Jesus keeps on talking about going to die and talking about something that he's not expecting, he's like, Jesus is not going to try to overturn the Roman government. And so when Jesus is saying, yeah, sure, I am the Messiah that you said, but let me explain that and clarify what I mean when I agree to what you say as the Christ, the Son of God. So he clarifies that by saying, but I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Here, the way that they would understand it is Jesus is saying that he is now equating himself to God, sitting at the right hand of God, the seat of honor and power, and he is going to be the one judging and ruling. So while Caiaphas is demanding an answer from his seat of power as he stands, Christ claims to be God that sits in a higher seat. My authority supersedes yours because he is equating himself to be God. This sets off the high priest. He goes, you see this great emotional response, because we're told that he tears his robes. And for us, I don't know how many of us have ever experienced that. I don't know if we ever respond and express our frustration and anger by tearing our clothes. I think of some of our members here at church that really love their clothes. And I would just love like one day for like Minister Theo to be up here. It's like, I'm so angry. No, I got undershirt. Right? I'm like, oh my gosh, that's like, right? So this is crazy, because you might think, oh, I've heard this before, right? In their culture, they'll tear their clothes when they're really like to show their sorrow or frustration. But the high priest is The high priest does not do this. The high priest typically, they do not tear their clothes. It's even said, right, when they're to mourn, the high priest will not tear his clothes. But even for them, like, the culture, like, people would, like, you know, tear their clothes as a form of showing their sorrow. They're like, no, not for the high priest. The high priest, you should not do that. So here, when he does that, it's, again, very out of the ordinary. He's doing all the things high priests do not do. He is standing to address, and now he's ripping his clothes off. He is showing great frustration and anger because he accuses Jesus of blasphemy. Now, there's just a whole bunch that you can talk about there, which is incredibly ironic because, one, their understanding of blasphemy, there's many different ways, but one of them, for sure, is using God's name. Like, just even speaking the name of God would constitute as blasphemy. And here, the high priest tells Jesus, all right, I adjourn you by God, and he says it himself. Like, he actually says God's name. But if you read what Christ says, he says the seat of power. He calls God power. He changes it and kind of and substitutes it with not God, but with power. So Jesus actually doesn't even do that. But this high priest himself actually would be condemned for blasphemy for saying what he said. But that doesn't matter. They see what Jesus is saying about himself. And they're like, there's no way we're submitting to this Christ. He has called himself God. They tried to wield their sword of judgment, but they ultimately fall on their own sword. Their depraved, corrupted, sin-cursed hearts are so unwilling to accept Jesus' authority, they find it absolutely repulsive. And there's no way they're going to submit to Christ. They have too much to lose. So in their depravity, instead of seeing Christ's authority as a comfort or security, they see it as a threat, and they're quickly rejecting it. You see, our tendency, apart from the intervening work of the Holy Spirit, is to reject Christ's authority over our own lives. We want to reject his commands. We want to question his goodness, question his words, question his claims. Like, man, who are you to say such a thing? How dare you make this claim over my life? We face these same temptations we actually find from the very beginning of creation in Genesis chapter 3, where the serpent went to Adam and Eve and was talking to Eve. He said, did God really say that? You know that God is actually withholding good things from you. It says, right, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And Adam and Eve, even from there, were tempted to reject God's authority and God's commands because they're like, God is just wanting to hold good things from you. How can you listen to that type of person? How can you listen to that type of God? He doesn't want the best for you. He is selfish and vindictive. Like, listen to me, random snake that you find in the garden. I know what's best, but it struck something in their hearts. Maybe God doesn't want me to have this because he doesn't want me to have good things. And here they're tempted to reject the commands of the Lord because they're like, wait a minute. Is this really the heart of God? Like, is this really what's best for me? They rejected God's authority by rejecting his character and goodness. And here, we see that kind of same thing over again. Like, oh, you are challenging the status quo. You're challenging my power. You're challenging my autonomy. I get to make the calls here. And here you are trying to tell me that you are higher than me? No, we're not having any of this. Confronting Christ either breaks down our defenses and we actually yield to him, or we find destructive ways to reject him. And ultimately, we reject Christ's authority when we reject the gospel. The gospel he tries to discredit Jesus with is when we reject the gospel itself, is actually rejecting Christ's authority, because Christ commands us to repent and believe, to come to him for forgiveness, to not lean on our own righteousness, but to trust in his righteousness. Yet when we look at ourselves, we say, I am not that bad. I don't need to be forgiven. I don't think I'm a sinner. We're saying, your punishment is evil and wrong, Jesus. And when we do that, we ultimately reject his authority over our lives. Friends, heed the warning this morning. Do not reject Christ any longer. He's the one that will stand in judgment. And the only way we can stand before him is when we do not stand on our own merits, but we stand on Christ's righteousness given to us. He freely offers all that to those who surrender and follow him. Trust in him. Welcome his authority. Do not delay. And instead of responding to his authority, they instead pass judgment on Christ. And here we see our last point. The reality is our depraved hearts deserve death. But look at what is said here. Look at verse 66 through verse 68. What is your judgment, says the high priest. So here they want to judge Christ. They answered, he deserves death. Then they spit on his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is it that struck you? And after Jesus once again declaring his authority as the Son of God, the Christ, the Messiah, instead of responding in repentance and faith and obedience, they called Jesus a liar. They accused him of blasphemy. They're literally accusing Jesus of the very things they've done themselves. In rejecting Jesus, they called Jesus a blasphemer and a liar, while they blaspheming against the Son of God that sits in their very presence. By calling him a liar, they are standing accused of the very thing they're accusing Jesus of. On top of that, they broke the commandments of the Lord. The ninth commandment, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. Yet here they are looking for anything, any sort of false testimony, so they can break the sixth commandment, you shall not murder. Here they are in their arrogance, believing they are the arbiter of truth and righteousness. They condemn Christ. In verse 66, Caiaphas asks the council in the presence, what is your judgment? Their answer, he deserves death. The one person that did not deserve that judgment was receiving it from the very people that actually deserved that judgment. And you see the disrespect. And disrespect is not even a strong enough word for what's happening here. They spit on his face, struck him, slapped him. We're told in other gospels that they had him blindfolded. And this is why they're saying, prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is it that struck you? They're literally saying, if you're Christ, the Son of God, and you're the ones, you're claiming to be God, we blindfold you, we're going to hit you. Why don't you tell us who hit you? If you think you're so almighty and powerful and strong, tell us. Right? Oh God, tell us who hit you. This actually, ironically, reminded me of a game that we played one time when I was in college, where we blindfolded the birthday boy and all the guys surrounded him, and one at a time would go and punch him, and he had to guess who punched him. But there we know that there's no way he would know when there's like 10 guys around him because he's not God. Can you imagine Christ be like, Andrew, stop it. Oh my gosh. Like, can you believe that? It's like, I see you, Caiaphas Jr. I don't know who's there. Right? Like, wouldn't that freak them out? They were so blinded. They didn't think that he was Christ. Can you imagine if Jesus spoke just their names, all of a sudden, I don't know how you would feel at that moment. Oh my goodness, I'm maybe hitting God, right? But here, Christ absorbs it all. Doesn't say a thing. And they're mistaking Christ's patience for ignorance. And they did it at their peril. We might read this and we might think to ourselves, we would never do something like this. Surely, we are sinners in need of grace, but we are not like those type of people, are we? The violent response to protect their status quo, I would never dare do anything like that. But how many of us have whispered in our own hearts, are you really the Son of God? When your expectations were let down, when you didn't get what you've been praying for, when you see others succeed, when you work so hard and envy boils up inside of you, you see, the reality is we are closer to rhyming with the hearts of Christ's accusers than identifying with the hearts of Christ. We are so much closer than we realize. Their response, physically, oftentimes, is our heart response when we reject him. Even this morning, we sung in confession, "Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers." All of our hearts, apart from the intervening work of the Holy Spirit, finds more common ground with this council than we would like to admit. And with that, without Christ, we stand condemned as well. Our depraved, sin-cursed hearts deserve death. Yet the irony is, the great and beautiful irony, Christ stood silent and took the shame, took the attacks, took the beatings, took the sins of those with depraved, sin-corrupted hearts. We are the ones that deserve death, yet here he stands in our place for all those who profess him and trust him. Unjustly condemned, mercilessly treated and tortured, and ultimately crucified. Do not mistake Jesus portrayed here as weak and helpless. No, friend. He is stronger and more powerful than ever because he is beginning to bear the burdens that we deserve, yet he does it with a heart of humility and patience and kindness. He is fulfilling Isaiah chapter 50, verse 6. It says, "I gave my back to those who strike and my cheeks to those who pull out the beard. I hid not my face from disgrace and spitting." He is the promised suffering servant in Isaiah 53. And while our hearts filled with corruption and hopelessness and sin, Christ's heart says, "I will obey the will of God. I will humbly trust him. I will walk to the cross. I will endure the shame. I will bear the sins of those who mock, scorn, and shame me." Friends, this morning, hear the good news. While we deserve death, he bore it on behalf of those with depraved hearts. People like you and me, he came to fulfill righteousness that we could not do on our own. And the amazing and captivating news about the gospel is that Christ didn't only come for sinners like you and me. He came to save sinners like us that actively opposed him and wished him ill. The love, mercy, and humility Christ shows is the will that wins his people, not with force, but with grace and love and kindness. Will you turn your trust to him today? Will you allow him to bear your sins so you won't have to bear the death that we all ultimately deserve? This trial paints an ugly picture of darkness and death of sin from the high priest and this very council. But make no mistake, we do not deserve to stand in judgment of them, because it reveals the depravity of our own hearts and how our own impulse is more similar to this group than we care to admit. But even through this great injustice, we see the humility of Christ's heart and obedience as he continues to walk towards the cross. We're called to continue to repent, surrender, and follow after Christ. The only remedy for our sin-cursed heart is the blood of Christ shed for our forgiveness. Saints, do not forget the depth of our sin that we are saved from, the perfect righteousness credited to us, so we can now be called holy, righteous, that we get to be called saints. Let us abandon our sin once more and run after Christ today, the only one that changes hearts, the only one that forgives sins. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so much like this group of people that want nothing to do with Christ. Our own rebellion, our heart that just wants nothing to do with you, Lord. But we thank you through the intervening work of your Holy Spirit. We can now see and know and understand your goodness, your grace, your mercy and kindness. Lord, let us not be those that take advantage of that. I pray, Lord, for those who do not know you this morning, that they will turn their hearts towards you to seek your forgiveness, to be redeemed and reconciled, to be adopted into your kingdom. Work on all of our hearts this morning, Lord. For all this, in your son's name, amen.
I invite you to stand as we sing our song of response.
Was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy in life has led me to the grave. I had no hope that you would own a rebel to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse you soon. Hallelujah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus is to the cross. You looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross, and I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath deserved for me. Now all I know is grace. Hallelujah.
Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen. Thank you for worshiping alongside us this morning. Have a very blessed week. I love you.